Let us pray. Father God, we're so grateful that we have another chance to break the bread of life. We ask that you will open our hearts and our minds to receive not what this man is going to say, but what thus saith the Lord. And as we do that, let us get it in our hearts that we sin not against you. In the mighty name of Yeshua Messiah, we pray. Now, I want you to understand something. We're going to commence at the first verse. But it's a lot within this. It's 12 is one of God's perfect numbers. All 12 disciples, we've talked about that. 12 gates. All of that stuff. So I want you to keep in mind there's some very incredible truths there if we would just listen and allow God's word to speak. Solomon, God blessed him with wisdom because he asked God to give him the wisdom to walk in and out before so great a people. And God says, because you didn't ask for riches, nor did you ask me to just wipe out your enemies, that's my danger. I'm going to give you both. I'm going to give you wisdom and wealth. And the minute we begin to live for God, we may not realize it, but he'll give us wealth too. All right, let's start. Start at the very first verse. And it is so beautiful if we would allow it just to speak. And that is, it says, who so loveth instruction, loveth knowledge. Now we know in Proverbs, you say, get knowledge, but get understanding. I think it's around Proverbs 4, I may be wrong, young kid. But he that hateth reproof is brutish. In other words, you can't tell him anything. You get one of them folks in front of you, no matter what you say, they got to come back like, I don't want to hear all that. I don't believe in that stuff. Well, you have to tell them. Don't force it. Tell them have a nice trip. Because they're going to have one. And see, what we must understand, this is like a contrast between God's people and the wicked, those that will not acknowledge God, those that will not allow God to be the head of their life. Now, if we allow God to be the head of our life, then it says a good man, woman, boy, or girl, obtaineth favor of the Lord, but a man of wicked devices will he condemn. And we must understand that God is not going to honor but one thing. That's right. Anything else, you got to deal with it. And you might think you're getting away with it now. Nobody gets away. We all have to stand before the judgment seat of God. Now let's keep on reading this very, very closely, because there's so many beautiful truths in here. This particular Proverbs even reaches into the third heaven age and the third earth age. But we must begin to let God's word speak. And just like up in the In 11th chapter, in the 30th verse, it tells us the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. And he that winneth souls is wise. Keep that in mind. See, now you don't save anybody, but your life and how you let your light shine and how you allow God to work through your life, even though people might say, I don't see how they're going to make that. But see, but God does. He knows all about it. Now listen, third verse. A man shall not be established by wickedness. I think that's pretty plain, don't y'all? You're not going to do wrong and get ahead. It may look like you're getting ahead, but you're not. God said you're not going to be established. That means you might look like you got a nice home or this, that, and another, but everybody, no matter how high profile they are, they get busted when they do something wrong. You know, those guys that try to do inside trading, they think they're so smart, ain't nobody going to catch up with them, get busted. When those guys just rip people off because they come up with some investment scheme, they're not going to get away with it. But listen, but the root of the righteous shall not be moved. What did God ask us to be? Rooted and grounded in what? Love. That's the most powerful unseen force. And when we live the way God asks us to live, as he has forgiven you, so much you forgive others. In other words, love has to be the predominant thing in our whole life in terms of how we live, just how we act. Even though somebody might say something rather unpleasant to you, you still gotta love them. You don't take nothing off of them now, but sometimes they need a little attitude adjustment. But you let that righteous indignation raise up in you, and you won't go wrong. Look at verse 4. A virtuous woman is a crown to her husband. That might seem out of place there, but it's not. In other words, just like a godly man is a crown to his wife. Whosoever findeth a wife, the Bible says, find is a good thing. And conversely, it means the same for the husband. But she maketh ashamed. But she that maketh ashamed is as rottenness in his bones. In other words, she become a cancer. Now, what we mean by that, when a woman will just put her husband down, or dog him out, and embarrass him in front of somebody, or vice versa. Hey, that's like a cancer in somebody's life. And if you're a child of God, you don't have to worry. He'll take your business. Okay? You just read Psalm 37, and you'll be surprised what God will do. He's not going to let anybody mistreat one of his children. I'm sorry, I don't care who you are. When God knows, and he knows that he knows, because the Spirit of God has bared witness with your spirit that you are a child of God. And that means you have to live. That don't mean you let somebody run over you. That's not what it's talking about. But all you have to do sometimes is just put it in the hands of God. Because what God said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. This is where we all got to work on, beloved. At that fifth stanza, it's so important. The thoughts of the righteous are right. Now, where did most of this is your heart, right here. And how you think and what you do. If you let it be motivated by love, you'll always come out ahead. But if you say, well, I think I can, no. Always do the right thing. See, the thoughts of the righteous are right. Why are they right? Because they're coming out of the Word of God. We're getting Solomon, though he is the author, it's really God doing this, letting you know that do what you know is right. Even if it hurts, because if you do what is right, I will pull you up out of that trouble and you won't have anything to deal with, because I will be dealing with, I'll fight your battles if you just be still. But the counsel of the wicked are deceit. And I think we know that. I'm going to tell you, around politics, a presidential or an exit, whatever, just listen how ugly people, they say one thing, but they got an ulterior motive behind it. Whatever, they call it mudslinging or whatever. Come on. And they act like they're in control, but they're not. God is in control. Whoever God wants in the White House, that's who's going to be in there. And until man can claim he got it, no, he doesn't. And understand, when you know somebody is not living it, you're not judging, you're discerning. And God will give you that. But don't judge anybody, but he gives you the right to discern, which means just have good old common sense. If you know this person is a drug pusher, there's no need of you making him your friend. And I don't care how much they try to, you know. And remember, it goes both ways. Somebody who's doing wrong will try to use your righteousness and make them look like they are righteous. Okay? And don't think it doesn't go on. It does. Okay? Now listen, sixth verse. The words of the wicked are to lie in wait for blood. In other words, we're seeing it now. They're lying in wait, trying to figure out, can I find something out on him? Can I find something out on her? I mean, what they mean by blood, they want to destroy someone's credibility. And that's what we must do as Christians, always protect your credibility. In other words, you're going to do what is right. You're not on this earth just to destroy somebody. You're on this earth to lead someone to the love of God. As God loves you, he'll love them if they'll let him. But the mouth, listen, the mouth of the upright shall deliver them. Isn't that amazing that God uses our voice, be it over the TV ministry or whatever it is, the way you live, to affect somebody when you're not, you probably don't even realize you're doing it. But it says the word of the wicked are to lie in wait for blood. But the mouth of the upright shall deliver them. How do we deliver them? Give them what thus said the Lord. That's all you got to do. When God opens that door, you speak what he tells you to do, because it doesn't matter. Yes, we all have experiences. Yes, we all have been through some things. And it may appear that that person may be going to you through the same thing. And you can maybe share with them. But in most cases, we're all individuals. You don't have my fingerprints. I don't have yours. You know, everything that God built into you is for you. That's why I love Jeremiah 29:11. I know what my thoughts are towards you, love and peace, and give you an expected end. And we must trust that. Now, does that mean we can't help someone that's going through something? Yes, but not in the sight of what you're going through. Maybe 10 years ago, only thing you can give them that will help them is the word of God. Show them the scriptures that help you get through it. You see what I mean? I had to keep reading. I know he'll make up every one of my sick beds. I kept reading that to myself, even when I couldn't. I have it in my heart, and I ask it to play back so that I know God said, by his stripes, I'm healed. So these are the things we want to share and let them know that whatever God said, that settles it, and that is it. You can believe it. That's just God. Seventh, the wicked, listen, this is plain as day. are overthrown and are not. Well, wait a minute, that's true. They may look like they're gonna make it, but they're not. When real deal goes down, they gotta answer to Almighty God. And you just can't do anything and expect God to bless it. He's not. Yes, there's a other fella might carry you a little pay ways, but ultimately you're gonna pay. And that's what they are not. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. Now, but look, but the house of the righteous shall stand. That's why I tell you, 37, Psalm 37, around them 35, 36 verses, you'll see what God will do to the wicked. He kind of goes through a little ceremony, especially in Psalm 37, that how God equates the ungodly or the people when a lamb is spinning on a spit, where they roasting that lamb and turning it, and when the juice fall off that smoke comes up and it goes on forever. That's what, until that day when they're blotted out. That's why they are not. Okay? Listen very closely. A man, woman, boy, or girl, shall be commended, listen very closely, according to his or her wisdom. But he that is of a perverse heart shall be despised. Now why? That reaches way into Revelation. Your heart is your mind. The mark of God must be in your forehead. There's so many verses in Revelation. Revelation 7:3 saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea nor trees, till we have sealed the servants of God in their forehead. That's why we have the word of God in us. And by having it in us, we have no matter what it looked like. And when he kicked Satan out, and I've shared with you many times, Revelations 9:4, he commanded them that they should not hurt grass, nor of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their forehead. And that is Revelations 9:4. This is what I mean, it reaches back. Now, why is that important? Because as you read in Revelation, as you continue to go, and in Revelation 14:1, and I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father name, which is in their what? Forehead. This is what we're talking about over here. In other words, they have a perverse heart. They don't have the mark of God in their forehead as long as they have a perverse heart. You just can't have your heart contaminated with the foolishness of this world. Everybody, no matter what, they can push the homosexual agenda all they want to. I'm sorry. I love that person, but not that lifestyle. Now look. This idea, because Lord made me say this. Now I watch the station, I flipped. And sometimes I record something on my TV and it'll just jump to another station after it goes off. And they had a man on there, which, you know, pretend, I think he's a woman now. Listen to this. The guy was hitting on him and was whatever, and then end up going with his sister. you see, that type of verse can you get? I mean, you can't judge them, but that's the reality of it. They have a perverse heart. And the only one can change that is who? God. How do we save them? Let them know God loves you. He may not love what you're doing, but he loves you. I'm not going to sit there and point my finger and tell you you're wrong, because I'm not in a position to tell anybody they're wrong. But I do know what is right. And if you operate that way, it'll be all right. Now listen, he that is despised and, let me keep going, and have a servant is better than he that honoreth himself and lack bread. See, I just kind of twist it around there, but it's not. We're going to break that down. Let's go back through it. Let's listen to what. He that is despised and hath a servant is better than he that honoreth himself and lack bread. What is the word of God called? The bread of life. And sometimes, in many cases, some of the most ruthless folks are in folks that what slavery was about. You know, those that was in the house, their service, a lot of them, you see what I'm saying? But it's better than he that honoreth himself. In other words, self-ingrandation. But no matter what, they lack bread, the bread of life. It doesn't matter who you are. If you will ingrandize or honor yourself, and you don't lack bread, I'm sorry. That means you don't want to eat the word of God. And when you don't want to eat God, no matter how you try to make it look good, you can have service and damn it, you're doing it. But wait a minute. You're honoring yourself. And God's not going to honor that. And he's going to tell you. Now, but let's make it plain. The 10th verse make it even plainer. A righteous man regardeth the life of his beast. Now, what are we saying? God loves his animals. And they're going to be in the last, you know, in that, it come back. All you have to do is read Isaiah 11 and it show you. But why they can lay down, a lion can lay down by the lamb, because they will be changed into spirit. And they will not be carnivores anymore. But see, you must treat God's creation, even his animals, with respect. You can't claim anything. You don't feed any animal in the wild. You're not taking care of them. You see what I mean? You're not providing anything. But those that God give you to have, it's like when he brought them to Adam, and Adam named them. Those are domestic animals. And you must, you know, treat them right. But the tender mercy of the wicked are cruel. In other words, they can play the game, kicking your dog or your cat out, whatever. And you're not, or you're doing things that is against God's nature, or you're trying to breed something that God didn't design. I mean, a lot of these breeds of dogs was a result of man manipulating certain species. Okay, a pit bull is not a normal dog. We can do things because we're created in the image of God. But even the bulldog, with that big snout, I'm going to tell you the truth, I know some veterinarians. They say they get over on them because the dog can't breathe right, and they're always bringing them in there, see? So that's what I'm talking about. We must treat God's animals, the beasts, the meat, whatever. If you desire to have a dog, cat, or whatever, treat it the way God would treat it. He provides for it. Okay? Now listen, I love this verse. I wish we had a whole lot of young men and everybody in there so they can understand. I'm sorry, you can't just lay around on your gluteus maximus and expect to find a job. Now the etymology of this is, he said, he that tilleth his land shall be satisfied with bread. Now we're talking physical. If you work and you do it honestly, you will be satisfied with bread, because Jesus said, I will supply all of your needs according to my riches and glory in Christ Jesus. But now, but if you don't even attempt to do anything, I'm waiting on the Lord. But you ain't went out looking for no job. You're not waiting on the Lord. You're sitting down on, you know, you gotta try. And we must understand that. That means if God gives you an idea for something, you must do your best to try it. And it's just like anything. If I'm doing something and I at least give it 3 tries and it just don't work out, I know God don't want me to go that way, but I must try. In other words, he said, if you till his land, shall be satisfied with bread. In other words, God will honor. Some of us have so many incredible ideas in our head, in our heart, but we won't act on them. And I'm going to tell you the truth. I saw something on television where, man, just like me, I got a big old head. He said, man, I got tired of buying glasses and they wouldn't fit me. So he started whatever they call it, like those big, whatever them things that the kids get that they put on their wall, fat heads. But see, he called them fat head, but he couldn't use the word fat head. He put a Z at the end, fat heads. So now, and this guy is in Indianapolis, and he had that idea and would not let it go till he found people. He had to know somebody was just like him. And he acted upon it. But, listen now, but he that followeth vain persons is void of understanding. Now, what does that mean? Somebody with one of these get-quick schemes or the hustle or whatever, you're following a vain person. You're following nothing. That's what vain means, nothingness. It's not going to work. If you're trying to beat somebody out of some money, or it's not legal, or whatever, you know, they call them Ponzi schemes and all that stuff, you might look like you got the dough rolling in, but it'll be going out a hole in your pocket, because you lack understanding. He's saying you don't realize what you're going to bring upon yourself. You're going to be scared to open your door at night. You wonder if the police or somebody gonna come in and rob you. All that stuff. You lack understanding. There's no need for a child of God to do anything illegal. God will take care of his child if they will just obey his word. Now, the wicked desireth the net of evil men, and that is true. There are people who want to be a made man. I'm not going to get into what I think y'all know. If in organized crime, he wants to be a made man. In other words, that's a net of evil. I don't care who you are, you're going to get caught. That's what he's talking about. And we must begin to listen to God. Yes, there's a lot of good things out there that seem right, that you can hustle and this, that, and other, and do that, do the thing, fine. And I'm not gonna dog people out by playing the lottery. As long you do it for recreation, that's fine. I can't point a finger at nobody. But when you start taking the money that will feed your family, you're falling a vain thing, and you're playing into a net of evil men, because eventually, you know what, Gamblers Anonymous, all that's out there. You see what I'm saying? You're not gonna get away with it. But the root of the righteous yieldeth fruit. Oh, listen to that, beloved. What the fruits of the Spirit? Patience, love, all of those things. You know, your ability not to just go off the deep end. You're not doing this. You're allowing the Holy Ruach, or the Holy Spirit, to control that inner man. You put that in charge. And if you don't, the body gonna work the way it's supposed to. Now, yeah, I'm sorry. You're not gonna get around that. Now look at the 13th verse. The wicked, this is so plain, Calvin, the wicked is snared by the transgressions of his lips. Now you and I, as a child of God, know we know life and death is what? In the power of the tongue. Okay? If you decide to, you say evil and keep talking about it, you're going to end up doing evil. I've had dudes, when I came up, everybody knew you couldn't have no liquor and dating at night, especially, y'all may not know about the classic theater, y'all from Kentucky, but you used to have a whole lot of folks would go over to Indiana. So you could go over to Indiana, cross the line, it's 24/7. You can buy any amount of liquor you want. So the guys would go over there and buy them and bring them back, and wherever the dance, they'd sell them. And invariably, once that liquor started moving through that thing, somebody get stabbed, somebody got shot. I mean, I'm just sorry, that's just the way it is. And you really ain't making no money, because you done spent all your gas money, and everybody gonna try to hustle you out of them, beat you out of it, so it's not working. Lord, have mercy. But listen to this. I love this. But the just shall come out of what? Trouble. Wouldn't have it. But the just will what? Come out of it. Why? Because they're honoring Almighty God. They're doing the best that they can to live as righteously as they can. And that's all we can ask. And that's all God asks, to do the very best that you can. And then I'll take care of the rest. See, you don't have to do nothing unusual. You just have to live the way God would have you to live. 14. Oh, I love this too. A man shall be satisfied with good by the fruit of his mouth, and the recompense of a man's hands shall be rendered unto him. I say, look, come, what is it? Do the right thing, work honestly. And whatever you do honestly, however you speak honestly, you do what you know is right. A man shall be satisfied with good by the fruit of his mouth. In other words, if you don't walk around always talking negative, I'm a poor me, baby, I can't, you know, I don't have no job, it stoops the shoulders when you have that kind of an attitude. See what I mean? You always been over. But now, with with good by the fruit of his mouth, and the recompense of a man's hands shall be rendered unto him. That reaches into the end times, because when you're serving Satan, you didn't realize you're doing it. We can show you scripture, we'll get there, but your hands are doing his work when they should be honoring God. Shall be, and that goes both ways. You're going to be rendered for your good, and that person's going to be rendered for their bad. I'm sorry, that's what the book says. 15, the way of a fool. And even in the Hebrew, etymology, a moronis, a moron, that's where we get the word from, is devoid. What that means, that person is devoid of God. The way of a fool is right in his own eyes. In other words, they can't do nothing wrong as far as they're concerned. They don't have no, just have some kids that they had no parents dealt with them, and when they get to school, they buck wild. I wouldn't doubt if y'all ain't running into some of them now. And while you feed, they just, some have discipline and some don't. That's just the way it is. But he that hearkeneth unto counsel, hearken unto counsel, is wise. What counsel? We're getting it right now from Proverbs. That's good counsel. You can live by it. You can act on it. You know it's right beyond a shadow of a doubt. God said it. That settles it. And it doesn't matter what anybody thinks. Well, you shouldn't be doing whatever. Where are you going? Tell them, have a nice trip. But when you listen to the God's word, that is the only thing that cannot be condemned, because it said sound speech cannot be condemned. This is the only thing that you can speak and it's sound. Listen, a fool's wrath is presently known. In other words, you hear somebody, I'm going to get that so-and-so. He messes, you know, just running off at the giblets. And sometimes while you fat mouthing, something really does happen to that person. And the first person they're going to pick up is you. And you may not have did it. But it's presently known. What that means, you just dumped the whole wagon. Just didn't care who knew. I'm lying, da, 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 da. But a prudent man covereth shame. In other words, you cover whatever you thought that was not of God with the blood of Christ. In other words, if we sin, what did God say? Confess it, and I'm faithful and just to forgive it. There's nobody in this ever lived for God or what. They haven't done something they're ashamed of. But we can, the beauty of it, we can take it to our Father and ask him for forgiveness. We don't need to take it to anybody else. Just talk to Daddy. I know I made a mistake, Father. Forgive me. Now, whom I love, I chase it. He may have to put the paddle on you. Go on, kiss the paddle. Because you know you did it. You see what I'm saying? And he just promised you up there, you shall come out of trouble. We just read it. You may have done something that got you in a little difficulty. But if you honor God, you will come out of it. Now, is God sanctioning wrong? No. He's saying, you're honoring me, and therefore I will honor you and give you that which is right in my sight, not the precedent of the world. All they want is a precedent. I wish they'd leave OJ alone, but they won't do it. He's already paying his. He's paying for what he's done. Either way it goes. But for somebody to just come out and say, I know he killed it. No, you don't. And I got some people just flat out say it. And it must ain't read. You must give an account for every word that come out of your mouth. And when people understand that and they hear from the word of God, you're not so loose with your lips. That's what he's talking about. And loose lips are sinking ship. You understand what I'm saying? It's just that simple. And sometimes you'll say some things that you thought that person was your friend, and next thing you know, woo. So that's what he wants you to have. A prudent man covereth shame. You may have said something you're ashamed of, but just put it under the blood. That's all you can do. Once something get out, you can't bring it back. But you can take it to God and say, Lord, have mercy. Now listen what the Lord said. He that speaketh truth, oh, help me, Jesus, showeth forth what? Righteousness. What's the only truth? My word is truth. All you do is read John 17 chapter. He tells you that. My word is truth. See, God, Jesus is the Logos. Jesus is the living word. And we were on vacation. Well, I can't remember where we were. And a guy was a painter. And he saw my cross. And he said, I got to ask you a question. What does Logos mean? I said, that's the living word of God. Jesus is. He said, that's true. And I broke it down two or three. Now, I didn't do it. You know who was doing it. God was doing it. And I don't know. I may never see that man again to heaven. But you must speak. He that speaketh truth showeth forth what? Righteousness. If somebody asks you a question, God say you must be ready to give an account as to why you have that hope. Let me give a few more verses. If y'all want to leave because you've been here an hour, and that's how it's supposed to be. But a false witness deceived. See, a lot of folks want to cover a lie with another lie, and then another lie, and another lie, and pretty soon, they don't even know what the truth is anymore. There is that speaketh like the piercing of a sword, but the tongue of the wise is hell. Now, I don't think I need to explain. If some folks are just argumentative, gonna try to put you down, they just can't help it. But now we know what is the greatest sword, two-edged sword, is the word of God. Now, even when somebody is just ripping you. Now, David, one time it was one of his enemies was up on a rock, and I think he called David everything but a child of God, and one of David's men wanted, them words was piercing. I mean, he was cutting him to the quick. And one of David's men said, let me go up there and kill him. David said, that's why he's a man after God's own heart. Don't bother him. Maybe some of the things he was saying was the truth. So I want y'all to understand, when somebody going off on you, beloved, they might be helping you in a way that even you might not understand. But their piercing words, sure, but the tongue of the wise is help. Though they may be ripping you, you come back with what? The love of God. Oh, help me, Lord Jesus. But look at the 19th verse. The lip of truth shall be established. How's it going to be established, beloved? Forever. That's God's word. That's the only thing. It's forever. You cannot get around it. I don't care. You can't buy your way out of it. I don't care what it is. You must deal with this word. I don't care how you try to put it down. I mean, I've seen things on television and lately. I don't know why Lord made me watch these things, but every miracle in the Bible on the History Channel, they had some scientists trying to say, come up with a way that scientifically that this thing could have been done. or they were very slick tongued. Well, we're not saying it didn't happen. We're just trying to show you a way it could have happened, because they had this, and when Elijah was up there, he probably knew about this certain thing in the ground, and it wasn't water that he poured on. They came up with some kind of chemical. It was, in other words, they. Ooh, it's unbelievable, see. But we don't care what they say. The word of God will be established. But a lying tongue is but for a moment. And see, all they're talking about ain't nothing but a moment. Ain't nothing but a moment. Deceit is in the heart of them that imagine evil. Beloved, there's so much evil thinking around all of us, but we cannot allow it to affect us. Just like now, I keep telling you, I just can't wait. It really disturbs my spirit the way stuff is going on. Sometimes I don't even want to watch the news or anything like that. I don't want to hear nobody talking about it. Because I know who's in charge, and they be saying, "Oh Lord, if so and so get in there, these Christian folk, we ain't gonna have it." Whoa. The seed in the heart, that mind, they imagine evil. But to the counselor of peace is joy. See, when you do, let that Prince of Peace, that wonderful counselor, that ever-loving Father, let him lead, guide, and direct you. And you won't have any problems that God Almighty cannot deal with. Beloved, there shall no, please underline this, please, this is the one of the most beautiful and poignant verses. All the word is good, but he makes it plain. There shall no evil happen to the just. Is that plain enough for you? What the Bible says, the just must live by faith. You must live because you love God, you love his word, and you're going to believe his word no matter what. My God. I'm going to read that again because I get happy. There shall no evil happen to the just, but the wicked shall be filled with mischief. That's amazing. There's people right now trying to figure out a way to beat somebody out of something. They're just sitting up and they're just filled with it. Just think about that. You're just thinking about doing evil. There's a program coming on TNT. I don't know what they call it, but it's a whole family. And that's all they do is rob. Think about that. And they putting that on cable television. That's all they do. Oh. Babies, I'm going to do one of the last stanza, and we're through. I want y'all to listen to verse 22. Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord. As another one, every child of God need to listen. He says lying lips are an abomination. There ain't no white lies, little white lies, no just little, it's lying. And when you understand, that's why you've heard me tell y'all many times, tell the truth, even if it hurts. Because when you lie, lying lips are abomination to the Lord. Now you must understand, he putting you in the same category as murderers, whoremongers, you know, effeminate, all the, hey, I'm not putting myself in that because I'm gonna tell a little lie. Hey, no. It ain't worth it, what I'm saying. But they that deal truly, oh, y'all better hear it, are his delight. Now think about what that word is. In Psalm 37, it says, if you delight yourself in the Lord, God will give you the desires of your heart. Beloved, I know you, these are the things we got to get internalized and know that God honors his word. We must avoid lying at any cost. I'm sorry. Now listen, a prudent man concealeth knowledge. Now I want to really explain that. I don't need to show everybody, well, I went to seminary and I'm going to talk. No, God told me to prepare food for whosoever will. Feed my sheep, feed my lamb. I don't need to show you how much I know. I need to show you how much God knows. And see, whatever knowledge I have, that's why I'm saying you can't tell anybody what you've experienced. That's your knowledge. And that's what you must conceal. And I was hoping the Lord let me get to that verse. But a prudent man concealeth knowledge. But listen, but the heart of the fools proclaimeth what? Foolishness. Just ratchet, y'all. Just flying off at the lip. Ain't making no kind of sense. And ironically, beloved, a whole lot of folks believe it. Yeah, I mean, there's some stuff out there. I can't believe they believe that. They can't believe Christ. Okay? It's amazing if you study some of the well, I ain't gonna call no name. I mean, when I was in some of the stuff they was, I said, man, do you think that's divine? I said, yeah, no. They got me in trouble. I don't care, but I ain't gonna say something divine if it's not. Okay? Because I'm feeding into their foolishness. The hand, listen very closely, beloved. The hand of the diligent shall bear rule. Now don't think we're going to rule over something. You will serve. The greatest among you will be a servant for all. See, I earned the right to break the bread of life, number one, if I rule my household well. Now that don't mean I'm, no. It means how well I serve it. I'm gonna make sure that things are taken care of around the house, that they're fixed and safe or whatever I can do. But it's God's house. And every time I go on vacation, I say, your house is all right when I get back, that's good. Let me finish this and we can get ready, have prayer and we can leave. But the slothful shall be under tribute. In other words, they're going to always be under something. They're going to pay too much for something. How many folks had to go to, because they're not diligent about their work, they got to go to them off-the-wall car companies and pay double what they're supposed to pay and say, if we're diligent and we conduct our affairs in an orderly manner, we're supposed to be the head, not the tail. And nothing wrong with having. But tribute means you are really under an incredible amount of interest that normally you wouldn't have to pay. Now remember I told you that one verse, I'm going to stop at 25. Heaviness, listen, heaviness, know where it said, where does it say heaviness where? In the heart. You're supposed to have the mark of God in there. Not no heaviness in the heart. A man maketh it stoop, but a good word maketh it glad. Father God, thank you for the privilege of serving you. And let us know that We must allow you in our heart to lead, to guide, and direct us. And know that if we keep our mistakes under the blood and take them to you, not to whomever, but tell you about it. Just talk to you, Father, and tell you something that you already know. But you're so glad when your child comes and just asks for forgiveness and they repent. And that's all they have to do. And you, whatever they've done, you turn it over, Father, to a clean sheet. Just like you told that woman, go and sin no more. Don't do that sin again. And Lord, I'm with you always, is what God is saying, even unto the end. And let's remember, Father, that we love you. We just adore you. We lift you up, and we give you all the glory. In the mighty, holy, righteous name of Yahweh, Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the living Word.